Right, chapter 7, documentation for nursing care. How are you going to use this? Why is this important to you? Nursing has made lots of strides related to documentation as it relates to nursing care. Right, we're going to talk about documentation, which is charting. This is when you say, oh my God, I need to sit down and chart. Yeah, that's you documenting. How does it correlate with the nursing process? How do we maintain confidentiality, privacy, whether it's on paper or electronic? And then there is five methods of written documentation. And then clinically, that's going to be with use of clinical significance as it relates to your patient's presentation and assessment and data collection of your patient. The reason why we chart is to create a timeline of events. To document care, it serves as evidence in a court of law. Whatever you put into your nursing documentation, that is a legal playing ground, so to speak, your battlefield. If you didn't chart it, you didn't do it. Okay, this shows use of the nursing process. This, why is nursing important? Your patients have a deficit and require nursing care. Well, what are you doing? If they're a stroke patient that can't move their left extremity, how are you caring for them? How are you providing them hydration, nutrition? What are you doing therapeutically for them? Right? We're thinking range of motion, we're thinking movement, we're thinking hygiene, right? All of those. It's also a compliance issue as well. Is what we're doing for the patient working? That's where your data comes in, your research, evidence-based practice, how the nursing profession can evolve. Okay, any events or treatments that are given will be used as a medical record. Again, we refer to the medical record as the chart. Some of your key terms to understand is going to be case management, charting by exception. One of my very favorites, and I'm sure most nurses will agree, computerized provider order entry, CPOE. Because, to see some of the ways that penmanship is used among medical degrees is sometimes scary. And I'll show you this when we're in class tomorrow. Okay. EHR, what is that? Electronic health record. Focus charting, pie charting. Problem-oriented medical record charting protocols and narrative charting, your stories, tells a story. Again, charting has been used since Florence Nightingale. She documented patient conditions versus in the environment and how she was able to care for her patients and prove that her care was working through data collection. Okay. Some forms of hospital documentation that's used, face sheets, graphic sheets, care plans. You'll be very familiar with those coming up. A care plan is, it includes problem statements, nursing diagnosis, goals, expected outcomes, and nursing interventions. Focus charting and charting, and then you have charting by exception as well. You may have commonly heard this as clicking the boxes. Okay. Some forms that you're going to see, I'm skipping ahead in the PowerPoint. I don't read directly off the PowerPoint. I give you guys a little bit extra. You can read the PowerPoint. Right. Admission forms are very useful. Why? That has your patient identification, conditions, consents. What is a consent? That's informed consent, which has to be collected before an invasive procedure or surgical procedure happens, meaning the patient has been advised by the surgeon, not the nurse. We are just the witness. We are attesting by signing that legal document that, yeah, the surgeon, doctor, physician came in, discussed the procedure. Ask the patient if they had any questions, explain risk and benefits, and that you watch the patient sign. If the patient has a question still on informed consent, You will get that surgeon or doctor back immediately and answer any questions that the patient may have. What is the advantage of some of these protocols that we follow? For example, narrative charting, right? This is you creating a chronologic timeline with nurses' notes, okay? The only problem is it takes a lot of time. A lot of time. If you need to sit and chart and write a story, basically, of what happened during your day, you're going to be there for hours. It's definitely a form of charting. Here's an example of you have your date, your time, your problem, right? Patient states sharp throbbing pain. We can objectively apply the pain scale to it. And I'll provide you guys with a pain scale. What time it started, vital signs to go with it. Was there any relief? Was there not? What medications they had? What position were they in? What is the subjective information? What's the patient saying? Etc. And then of course you sign with your name and credentials. That's one of the charting. Problem oriented. Yeah, this is focused on a medical or nursing diagnosis, or patient status, I should say. Okay, some of these advantages. It's a problem-solving approach, but everybody's problem-solving is not going to be the same as the other one. You can also evaluate if you're a nurse manager. One day you might be the nursing supervisor of your peers, and how are you going to evaluate staff performance? This is one way. The only disadvantage, you're going to lose your timeline, and it's harder to track trends in status. They also have pie charting, but before I start on that, I want to continue about confidentiality. We need to maintain confidentiality. Healthcare information portability and Privacy Act, HIPAA, we cannot break that. You need to keep, if you can, if you're taking care of a patient and then now you're on break going to lunch, you're not going to sit and discuss any patient details or especially identifying factors in a public place or at all. You can go, the only person you can go home and talk to, who you took care of, what happened to them, who is your dog or your cat or not even the bird, because they can repeat names. It's the cat or the dog, that's it. Don't share your patient identifiers. Protect them. When you have a clipboard in your hand, you face that down, secure it, close it, lock it, whatever you need to do. Shredding paper. Okay? That's important. Regarding problem-oriented medical records, you have to have certain contents of it. You have to have your initial assessment, your database, a problem list, a plan, progress notes, right? That contains your assessment, physician orders, what other nurses were involved in the care. There's another way you can even do nursing notes or progress notes. We call that a SOAP note. Just like what you wash your hands with, soap. SOAP stands for the S, subjective data. That's about symptoms and the patient's verbiage on the problem. How are they describing it? Right? The O in SOAP is objective data. This is based on observations, your examination, head to toe, diagnostic assessments, vital signs, anything that can be measured objectively. Your A in SOAP is just that, it's analysis. Or assessment, meaning your data collections. LPNs have a significant amount of knowledge as it relates to data collection. You guys do a fine job at data collection. And then you can include in there as well the P, plan. Plan to resolve the problem. And then, of course, you can include a summary on discharge as well. But SOAP notes is a way to formulate your your progress notes. You can even do SOAP-E notes or SOAP-er notes, meaning implementation, evaluation, or revision. Again, this is in chapter 7 I'm going on. I just wanted to elaborate a little more on problem-oriented medical record and how you can chart or how you can take down your nursing notes during your day. Because again, nursing is both a science and an art. Okay. Pie charting is another way. Whether you're going to use SOAP, the acronym SOAP, SOAP-E or SOAP-ier, pie is another option for you. Here's an example here. Problem, intervention, evaluation. It's simple, it's quick, it's to the point. Again, always follow your hospital policy and procedure and how they want you to formulate and complete your charting. But you'll find all these examples in chapter 7. All right. Focus charting, like I was saying, this is your diagnosis, problem, concern. This is what you're saying. Hey, did my assessment match my nursing intervention? And what was the patient's response? Okay. Quick charting chimes. You can make checklists like this. The only thing is you got to have the proper database to support this type of charting. Again, depending where you work, where depending where you work will negate how you're going to chart. Here's an example of focus charting. Diagnosis, right? Here we go. Slight serous drainage on dressing objectively measures the wound, right? Coca. We're going to look at the wound and look at the color, look at the odor, look at the consistency of any drainage and any amounts. Charting by exception is based on the assumption that all standards of practice are carried out and met with a normal or expected response, unless otherwise documented. This came out in the 80s from a group of nurses in Wisconsin. Their goal was to get away from the narrative charting that takes forever, and they were able to follow standards and protocol, and they eventually integrated flow sheets and forms. Right? This is where you're charting by exception is where you document abnormal findings. Okay, if the lungs are not clear like they should be, well, what are they? Are they coarse? Is there crackles? That's where you're clicking the boxes to what is abnormal. Okay, let's see here. The only problem is this presents some legal issues if the medical records charting in. Because of that, it highlights abnormal data and patient trends. Again, it decreases narrative and documentation time. One good thing about this, it decreases duplicates in charting as well. There is, so as nursing students, why are you learning this? There is some metrics that need to be met, meaning why information and technology skills are essential for patient care. If technology is your weak point, this is where you need to really hone in, focus, seek IT assistance because everything mo now is computer based. And you don't want to be charting until 9, 10 o'clock at night on a 12-hour shift. You want to get out at 7, not 10. We like to convey to you guys how patient care and quality safety is measured by way of these computerized charting systems that we have. This provides knowledge so you can recognize the time, effort, and skill for technology to become effective and a reliable tool. Again, they also pull data for research from this. The infection control nurse is going to come around. Excuse me, not the risk management can come around and say, listen, you had a stroke patient, but you didn't put any anticoagulation for this patient. Why didn't you give them their baby aspirin? What's going on? Right? Because you didn't chart. If you gave it to them and forgot to chart, then you never did it. Okay? So you got to think of it from all aspects. Next one is computerized Computer assisted charting. This is your EHR. This is part of nursing informatics. Informatics meaning this is the science and practice that integrates nursing information and its knowledge, right? This is a communication tool. The goal is for worldwide or globalized charting. One EHR. Okay, that was a goal. We still have not reached that, by the way, but hopefully one day we will. Meaning, if you were to travel to Italy and if you were to become hospitalized there, are they going to be able to pull up your records from South Florida? Odds are no. Odds are no. They're going to rely on your information or your family or friends, whoever's with you if you're hospitalized. Okay, but if we have a global electronic health record, we can, through informatics, pull up patient history immediately and chart in real time, essentially. Again, let's see here. Cues and considerations. Okay, let's. There's a couple of variations for computerized assisted charting. Again, these are done on bedside computers. Some of you have experienced hospital stays where they chart right at the bedside. That's the best way to do it. You're not, hopefully you don't omit any patient data there. And PS, never walk away from your computer without turning it off. I mean, logging it off. Okay. We need to protect our patients' information the best we can. We have a legal obligation to guard our password, not share it. Okay, we have to shred documents like reports, SBARs, anything with patient identifiers in there. Again, remember I said you have to conceal your patient information, keep it hidden so you not break HIPAA. And let me just share this. This is part of a legal and ethical consideration regarding charting or computerized records. You cannot access your, let's say you're working in long-term care and your mother-in-law is a patient there. You cannot access her record. You're not her patient. That is a conflict. She is not your patient. That is a conflict of interest and you are breaking HIPAA. You are not the nurse assigned to that patient. You do not need to know anything about what's going on. It is strictly confidential. Same thing. If my neighbor was hospitalized, I cannot just go fishing for information and say, "Ooh, what happened? I seen them leaving in the ambulance. Now I'm at work and I see their name pop up on the dashboard." No. Don't risk it. You get fired over that or worse. Okay. It's strictly a need to know basis, meaning your patient assignment is what I'm trying to say. All right, you have some. So back to the computerized chart. You got some advantages. It's documented in real time, meaning the date and time are automatically recorded. It's legible. You don't have to decipher somebody else's hieroglyphics that they're writing in, right? It's poor penmanship people that can't write or in a rush, right? You don't have to worry about that with computerized assisted charting. The providers all have access. They can get in there. They can look at lab values. It really, it's a quicker way, and it reduces documentation time and error. Problem is, it's quite a learning curve if you're not technologic tech savvy, so you don't prevent any unauthorized access. It's very expensive. This is like your huge hospital systems that have this type of charting. You have to train your staff, right? There's a lot of input. How is it organized, right? Not how it's organized. Case management system charting. This is pretty specific to case management. We normally don't get into the case management. However, I will talk about it. This is where your documentation has a pathway, meaning if you have a patient with, let's say, a diabetic wound, a venous stasis wound, let's say just a wound in general, right? And case manager wants to follow them. Okay, they came in on December 20th, with excoriation to their sacral region. And then all of a sudden, January 5th, they're reevaluated again. And now they have a stage 3 pressure ulcer. January 10th, they're about to be discharged to a long-term care unit. But what do they need? They're going to need wound care. This is where the case management can follow the case and say, all right, we've got a developing wound. This is what's going on. We've cultured what's in the wound. We've identified the cause, if there's a bacteria in the wound, meaning is it infected? How are we going to care for them? Do we need to order supplies for this person? Are they going home with home health care? Right? What do we need to get for this patient to take care of them? Do we need a visiting nurse? Okay. That's one of the best ways that I can describe the case management. Now, accuracy in documentation. We are the most trusted profession, nursing, okay? We should not be using slang or unapproved acronyms, hyphenations, anything like that. We can't just dream up a way to say high blood pressure or hypertension. Its approved abbreviation is HTN, if you're able to use that. Again, do not use slang. If the patient told some profanities, you don't need to add that in there. I've seen some that did. Do you have to? No. Should you? No. You don't need to go that far. Okay? It's too much. You can document behavior. You can document whether the patient's like resting or not. You want to avoid using terms like a small amount, a large amount, because those are ambiguous meanings. Okay, I don't know. I can't objectively measure what your definition of a small amount is versus my definition of a small amount. Okay, if somebody serves me a small amount of dinner, I'm gonna be very upset. I would like a large amount. Okay, so keep that in mind. We need to measure. How does this clinically significance? Well, whoops, I went too far. When we're talking about intake and output, what patient's appetite, what they ate, right? You want to know how much did they eat. That's why in Calculate with Confidence, we're teaching you how to do conversions. I don't want to know about it 1 ounce. I want to know that 1 ounce is 30 mL, and that's what I'm going to chart in. That is internationally accepted. That is proper for nursing. We're not going to document in we're going to document military time as well. Okay, so you need to. So we're going to go over how to learn military time. Back to this. That was for accuracy. Now brevity, right? Brevity in documenting. This is where you can utilize some omittance in your documentation. The word patient can be omitted, right? PT is an abbreviation, but again, you need to check out your facility protocols and policies on abbreviations, acronyms, and symbols. We used to use the with symbol. It looks like a C with a line above it. They no longer use that anymore at some facilities. You can leave out certain articles of a sentence like a and the. Those are acceptable to be omitted, right? It's like shorthand. Right, shorthand documentation versus longhand, meaning are you going to write a complete sentence or are you going to do shorthand and just write a couple of notes about it, getting to the gist of the points? Let's see here. Whatever behaviors are noteworthy, I'm not going, and you're not expected or legally bound to document every single word the patient says. No. You can document whatever is pertinent to your patient's disease process or what's going on with them. Okay. Let's see. A rule of thumb is that if the behavior or finding is abnormal or a change from the previous, document it. Good rule of thumb. If your writing is not legible, I will show you an example of it, legible handwriting versus illegible handwriting, right? Because you can make mistakes reading it. Same why we don't do a trailing zero. That three that you're gonna mismedicate your patient. No trailing zeros. What to document? Well, this is important to know, right? Besides legibility and completeness, you want to make sure that everything that you're documenting is pertinent, actually happened, okay? Data like vital signs, symptoms, information on what is going on with your patient, procedures. Those are good things to be documented. Let's see here. Degree of activity, diets, discharge, death, body care, dressings, wound cares, right? IV fluids, medicines, mental state, moods, effect, whether your patient's using oxygen, how's their pain, education, maybe operative care, both preoperative and postoperative, procedures, sleep, specimens, travel to the unit, tubes, equipment, visitors. Yeah, visitors are important, right? Did the visitor come in and slip your patient a narcotic and now they're coding? That's huge. We had that happen before. And again, there's certain guidelines documenting. What I want to talk about now, real quick, before I stop on chapter 7, is that you need to verify you got the correct patient's info before you start documenting. Number one, okay, don't document on the wrong patient, because then you have to go back in, strike what you said, and we don't scribble out information. We don't draw like a third grader over a word we misspelled. We draw one line through it, one line right in the middle. You're gonna put your initials, comma, credentials. Okay, because we cannot hide anything or seem like we are hiding anything. You must follow the 24-hour or military clock. Documentation is only to be done by the person who made the observation or performed the intervention and who's legally responsible. Meaning, if I were to go grab my friend down the hall, the nurse, and I said, listen, can you go and do the wound care on this patient? And she goes, yeah, no problem. And if I go document that I did the wound care, that is falsification of documentation. No, not gonna fly in a court of law. You're putting both of you at risk, and that patient should know. If I were to grab my friend from down the unit and say, hey, listen, Mr. Smith in 1B needs wound care to the right lower extremity. Can you help me? Great. You both go in there, and then after it's done, completed, you will both chart on the patient and or follow facility protocol and procedure for documentation. But that's the way, like a blood transfusion, right? Both of you go in there, you verify, you start the vital signs, you document, and you double check. Same thing like during surgery. They do a timeout. They verify the patient, the extremity, where the area is to be operated on. They identify, etc. So again, do not falsify any documents saying you did something when you didn't. That's illegal. Okay? When a patient refuses a medicine, right? You need to have an explanation. You can't just say, oh boy, well, I passed by the Smith's room and Mr. Smith was sleeping, so you don't need that. And you put refused when he really didn't because he was sleeping. Illegal. Don't do it. Okay? If the patient gives any behaviors, if they start saying, I don't want it, and then start with waving their hands or pushing you, then you document that. You need to spell correctly. Do not misspell stuff. If you're unsure, you better look it up. It's a legal document. You're a professional nurse. You have to document with proper spelling. If you suspect a medical error, you need to seek clarification or let someone know that you made an error when documenting. Follow your facility policy and protocol. Sometimes, if you make enough mistakes, they'll write you up for that. You don't do it. Take your time while charting. Two things. When you're passing medicines, no distractions. Don't talk to nobody. Don't answer your phone. Don't look at nobody. You focus on that med and the patient. Same thing for documenting. All right. So the key points for chapter seven. There are six main methods of documentation. We talked about them. Narrative style. We talked about the POMR style, focus charting, charting by exception, computer-assisted charting, case management. Besides nurses' and physicians' progress notes, many flow sheets are used, meaning flow sheet. How over the week that the patient's been with you, how's their blood pressure been? And they put it on a chart, like a table, and you can see, okay, Monday in the AM, that patient's blood pressure was 130 over 80. And then Tuesday in the PM, that patient's blood pressure was 80 over 90. And then the next day at 2 o'clock, it's 90 over 90. And then it gradually goes up, right? Are they trending low? Are they trending high? You can see it plotted on a chart. See if I got some key points here for you. When you're documenting a sign or a symptom, you need to know the exact location. Okay, the quality you're going to describe in the patient's terms, meaning if a patient's having a heart attack, they might describe chest pain as like squeezing, being squeezed or sat on by an elephant. The intensity, mild, moderate, or severe, that's where you're going to use your pain scale, which I'll show you. Number of times they've had chest pain or maybe vomiting episodes, nausea. We need to know the time, the onset, the duration, frequency, course of the symptoms, right? Do they stay the same? Are they better? Are they worse? Where is the patient? At home, in the bed, running, sleeping? Who's with the patient? Aggravating and relieving factors. What makes it better? What makes it worse? And then associated manifestations. Right? Did they have something that occurred with it? If you want to see some examples on documentation, you can find it in chapter 7. It shows you all the definitions of data collection. All right, that's what I have for chapter 7.